Hello, St. James family. Welcome to probably one of the strangest worship services we've had here in quite a while. This is unusual for us. We're not an online church, although we do provide audio of the services each and every week, and that's professionally done, and we're grateful that we can offer that to you. This may be the first time that we've actually video recorded an entire worship service, and something that you'll notice right from the start, we are not professionals in this area. But one thing that we are here to do is to provide you the Word of God so that you can feed, just as if you go to the grocery store and the workers that are there to provide you physical food. We want to provide and desire to provide you God's spiritual food. So that's why we are doing this for you. So whether you're watching or listening, we pray that the Word of Christ would dwell in you very richly. Just a couple of things for you to know about as we go through these very unusual times. We're going to try to do anything that we can to help you connect with God through the Holy Spirit, whether it's through a video worship service, or perhaps we may have Bible studies midweek, and we'll have those over and do those online, hopefully interactive. We're still working out the details on that. We don't know, but one thing that you can always do is go to our website to check for updates on anything that we might be offering in the future, and our website is www.sjumc.org, and we'll have updates there about what's coming up. Something that you need to know right now, though, is because of the restrictions that have been placed upon Athens and Clark County, the ordinance that was passed just this past Thursday evening for the mandatory sheltering in place, we will not be able to hold worship services on Sunday, March 22nd, the 29th, or April the 5th. The ordinance is supposed to lift on April the 7th, but the opportunity is there for them to extend it based on the progression of this COVID-19 and coronavirus. But we'll continue to keep you updated. Most importantly, we pray that God will richly bless you through these opportunities that He is giving us to provide for your spiritual nourishment. God bless you guys. We love you very much.
Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, in your presence, Lord.
Psalm 25, verses 4 through 5. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and and my hope is in you all day long. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Before our president ever declared that we are in a state of national emergency, on any Sunday morning or Sunday evening, you could go into a church and there would always be a time that is dedicated, that was set aside for people to place their tithes in an offering plate or maybe through a kiosk or something like that. And it was called a time of offering to God. Do you know why all the churches have that? Why something like that is built into place? It's because the act of giving to God what belongs to God, what we call tithing, and in the Bible what God explains that is that that's 10% of our income, is that what a tithe is, and that he expects us to give it to him. But when we do that, it's actually an act of worship. So we have worship services, but that's one of the most important parts of the worship that we give God, because we're essentially showing to God and declaring, God, I trust in you more than I trust in the money in my hand. You know, God doesn't need our tithes. He doesn't ask for our tithes for his benefit. He actually does it for our benefit, so that we can depend more on him rather than on the things that our finances can provide for us. It's a matter of who do we put our trust in. Now, for a lot of people, these are very emotionally upsetting times with this national emergency, and even our governor's declared we're in a state of emergency. And so people are wondering, well, gosh, now that my business is shrinking, even my income as well, my income is just being lopped in half, somebody might think. I can't continue to give at the same level, so, you know, what's the point? It's not a real tithe anymore. Well, what we need to understand is that God, when he looks at how we give, it's not the amount of what we give, it's that we give. That's what really registers to him, and he takes it as an act of worship and as a love offering to himself. So, you know, let's just say something really rough happens. I mean, your income has shrunk from $1,000 down to $100. No, it's not the same amount you could give, but you may say, well, does God want me to give this measly $10? Well, that is just as important as what you were previously giving, if it's your tithe. Because, you know, we evaluate things based on what we can see and what we can measure, but God measures the heart. That's how he always looks. And so just know that your gifts matter, that you give to the Lord. Know that he is pleased by your tithes. And Sherry and I are going to continue to give during this whole corona outbreak. We don't know what the future looks like for her job. She may be furloughed. Our income may be drastically reduced as well. But we're going to continue to give out of faithfulness to God. And I just encourage you to do so because, as Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than receive. So may the Lord bless you through your faithfulness. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you that you provide for us. Thank you, God, that you are the provider and we're not. Because if we had to depend on ourselves to make it another day, another week, another year, God, I'm not sure we would get there. Not in the way that we could if we're traveling with you. So God, we need you and we honor you. And we ask you would take what we give you from a heart of faith and, Lord, use it for the building of your kingdom so that people can hear the name of Jesus and so that the gospel message can continue to go forth. It is in Jesus Christ, Father, we give you thanks. Amen.
Comes from 1 Peter 1, 3 through 7, and I'm reading out the NIV translation so you can follow along with me. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into our inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had suffered grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. This is a reading of the word. This is a word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now we're going to join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. So please join me in prayer. Our Father
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's continue to seek the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you. For you are the most high and holy God. You are sovereign and you are good. You are the creator, the God who feeds the birds of the air and clothes the lilies in the field. Father, you love us so much that you sent Jesus. Jesus, we gather today to worship you. Our gatherings certainly look different, but you are the same. Yesterday, today, and forever, you are the same. Though it seems the world is falling apart, you hold it in your hands. You are before all things, Jesus, and you hold all things together. Holy Spirit, come and move among us. Teach us and comfort us. Lord, we confess that we've worshiped idols, not ones made of bronze or stone, but idols nonetheless. Those idols are being shattered. Many of our everyday comforts are being taken away. Our sense of any control has been stripped away, and we feel afraid. But we know you are sovereign and you are in control. Your word assures us that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we are not alone. Hold us together, Jesus. When fearful thoughts threaten to cripple us, let us take every thought captive to your obedience. Lead us away from fear and into service. We are your people, called to be salt and light in the world. Show us, O God, what that looks like now in our homes, neighborhoods, and communities. We pray for our leaders. Give them strength and wisdom. We pray for those who are sick. Bring healing, Lord. For those who grieve, lift up their heads. You tell us in your word not to worry, but to bring everything to you. So we ask for an end to the devastation of COVID-19. Take it away, Father God, in the name of Jesus. But let us not miss one thing that you have to teach us in it and through it. Let us be changed to look more like Jesus. Now, Father, I ask that you anoint our pastor to teach your word and proclaim the gospel. Speak through him and speak to the hearts of your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Jenny. I appreciate that. Well, during these days that we're in, as we experience a national lockdown, there's a lot of different emotions that people are going through. So what I thought I'd do is just mention something I saw on Facebook recently. By the way, my name is Bill Currington. If any of you all are watching online and you haven't seen my face before, I'm the pastor here at St. James in the Five Points area right off of Lumpkin Street and the Westlake Drive. And we welcome you to come and be with us whenever we can resume having church here in our sanctuary. But until then, we'll be offering online experiences. So welcome. But humor's good. It kind of relaxes us, and it just kind of helps us just to breathe and exhale, you know, any anxiety that we're feeling. So here's what I saw recently on Facebook. It said, if you told people that staying inside for 7 days would save the 2020 college football season, the entire South would be locked in their room right now. Well, that's really true, isn't it? I confess, I would probably be one of those locked in the room because of that, too, because I do like football. Well, I'm going to be reading here from the book of Mark, chapter 9, looking at chapter 9, verse 2. So I want to encourage you to grab your swords at this time. The Bible kind of describes itself as the words of Scripture are the sword of the Holy Spirit. So that's what we call that. And I definitely don't want you to be without your weapon today. So this is actually a good place, taking benefit of the online experience. You can actually hit pause here and go grab your Bible, like off your coffee table or beside your bedside, and then come back and then resume playing when you get it here. And then we will read through this together from Mark chapter 9, verse 2. And by the way, you know, you all have locks on your doors for your physical protection, but you have Bibles in your homes for your spiritual protection. So when we open up God's word and we read from it, God not only is building us in faith, but he's also protecting us in spirit from things that we might otherwise think are true, but actually aren't. So God protects us in so many different ways through what he teaches us with his very words. So I'll be reading this from Mark 9, verse 2. I encourage you just to follow along with me. I'll be reading in the NIV version here. It says, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up on a high mountain where they were all alone. So he left the rest of his disciples kind of like down in the valley, and he took these three disciples with him. There he was transfigured before them. Now, what that means is that actually they thought they were following just simply a mere man, somebody who was a really great teacher, somebody who could do miracles. But now, all of a sudden, they're seeing something about Jesus they had never seen before. They didn't quite understand what they were seeing in the moment, but what Jesus did was he let them see his divinity. He let them see the fact that this simply isn't a human being that you're learning from. It's me. I am. I am God. So that's what they were looking at, this transfiguration when Jesus was changed in front of them. Verse 3 says, his clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And that's to signify how holy he always has been. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. So this is Father God now speaking to the guys, to Peter and them. He says, this is my son, talking about Jesus. This is my son whom I love. Listen to him. Now may God put these truths into how we think, and may they change us and shape us. Would you join me in prayer? Almighty God, what matters is not what we say, but what you have written and what you telegraph to our spirits. We pray that you do that now, God. Come and make your word pop with meaning. Show us how, Lord, what you have written is relevant for us, and be our teacher, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come and help us to hear your voice. And it is in Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Okay, keep your Bibles open, because we'll be looking here back at this verse and then another one. In verse 5, Peter said to Jesus, when he saw that he was changed in front of him, and then all of a sudden, Moses and Elijah had made an appearance from heaven, and they're with Jesus. And so Peter, just blurting this out, Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Now, let me help you to key in on a couple things here real quick. When Jesus was changed in front of Peter and James and John, I don't want you to miss what happened. Back in the Old Testament, Moses was talking to God one time, and Moses said, Lord, let me see your glory. And so what God did was that he put Moses in this fold or in this crevice in a rock, and he put his hand over him. And he told Moses, he said, you can see my back. In other words, you can see part of my body, but you cannot see my face. And God's presence was going to pass right in front of Moses, but he would be shielded behind the hand, because it would be more than Moses could actually bear. So Moses got to see a part of his glory. Moses' prayer was answered in the life of Peter, because Peter got to see what he hadn't even prayed for. He got to see what Moses had asked for. Peter got to see the glory of God in Jesus Christ shining in all of its brilliance before him. He got to see God face to face. And so when you worship Jesus, you are worshiping the one that even Moses didn't know by name. And you are looking in the face in your heart, you're looking the face of God's glory when you worship Jesus. So that's a benefit that we get from God that, again, Moses didn't. Look here where Moses, or excuse me, Peter had an idea. It looked like a good idea. He said, let us put up three shelters. Now, what are shelters? Well, shelters are basically another word for tents. And so what Peter's referring to, we believe, is that back when the Jewish people were led by Moses away from Egypt and they were taken through the wilderness, what they had to do was they had to have these makeshift homes. You know, they didn't have time to build homes for themselves. You know, growing up in Gainesville, Georgia, I had a good friend of mine whose dad was in the mobile home business. So that's how he made his living. But did you realize that the Jewish people actually had created and were living in the very first mobile homes? Because their homes were tents. That's what they had when they were wandering around in the desert. They would erect their tents and they would break them back down and they would follow this cloud or they'd follow the pillar of fire and they would reset back up their mobile home. So it was a mobile home back then. We still have them today. And this tent that Peter's referring to here, let us put up three shelters or three tents. Back then, what God would do is there was something called a tabernacle. That's where the Jewish people would worship God. And that's where God's presence would come to be in the tabernacle. That was a larger tent. There was also something called the tent of meeting. And that's where Moses and Joshua would be. And this was a place where they would meet God. And so God's presence would come down in the shape of a cloud. And the Jewish people, all with their mobile homes or their tents spread out, they could see the cloud come down right in front of that single tent of meeting that Joshua and Moses were inside of. And when the cloud signifying God's presence would park itself right in front of the tent, then God would come inside and he would speak to Moses face to face. So that's where they met. So it was a place, these tents were the place, like the tent of meeting and even the tabernacle. This was the place where heaven came down to earth. So when Peter said, let us build these shelters, you know, he was trying to think of, okay, let's let heaven park itself down here on earth. This is where we can bring the people to meet God. Let us build shelters. We'll do it for you, Jesus. We'll do it for you, Moses, and you, Elijah. So it sounded like a really great idea, but there was a problem with it. It wasn't Jesus' idea. It was Peter's. And so God the Father used this as a teaching moment. And he said from the cloud, he said, guys, this is my son, Jesus, whom I love. Listen to him. So what Father God was doing was he was teaching Peter, don't listen to your ideas. Listen to Jesus' ideas. Don't listen to your ideas about what you think you need to build or what you think you need to do. Listen to my son. He'll direct you. Peter had to learn to listen to Jesus and not his own thoughts. The reason that he needed to listen to Jesus and Peter needed to tap on the brakes was because Jesus knew he had more important work to do. They couldn't stay up on the mountain. They had to get down in the valley. You know, we live in the valley. Jesus had more teaching that he needed to give his friends, the apostles, and he also needed to go to the cross. Now, what state of mind do you think that Peter made up this plan in? When he came up with what seemed like a really terrific idea, we'll build you tents here where you can stay. Well, look at verse 6. It tells us. It says that Peter said this. He did not know what to say when he had the idea of the shelters. He did not know what to say because they were so frightened. So it was out of fear that he came up with the plan. Be really careful about what decisions you make or what plans you develop in light of this lockdown as things are just rapidly changing our lives and we're having to adjust to this kind of new normal. You know, that this virus is making a lot of people afraid. It's also, I even heard from my wife today, she was talking to somebody who was really angry about it. She's angry about the disruption that it's causing in her life. And, you know, all these emotions of the anxiety and the anger is coming basically because of the fact that we are losing control of our world. Because when we are in control of something, it makes us feel safe. Well, God may be teaching us a lesson about what have we been putting our safety in? Is it the wrong things? Peter thought he had come up with the best thing, making the shelters. But sometimes the best thing we come up with may be the wrong thing that we come up with. One example for this, and one way that it's relevant that I'm thinking of, and this idea might be relevant in other ways in your life, is that I want you to pay really close attention to what people are saying on television now, because I've been hearing quite a lot of it. People, in order to give hope, you'll see this with the talking heads on TV, in order to give hope to their audience, you know, they were saying things like, and these are really good people who are saying it, but they're saying things like, you know, America has always been a resilient nation. America has always found a way out of its problems. We came through 9/11. We came through Pearl Harbor. We came through the Great Depression. We got through those things. We're going to get through this. Americans always triumph. Our nation always gets through the hardest times. Now, that sounds like a really good thing to latch on to, because if you're not careful, you can say, oh yeah, that's right, we have, that is historical, we have done that. But if we believe that, we're actually putting our hope in the wrong thing. Because friends, the reality is that our hope is not in our government to provide us with these emergency checks that we hear are coming to our mailbox. That's not our hope. Our hope is not in these brilliant doctors that are in America to come up with quickly the best antiviral meds they can so that everybody can be inoculated and everybody can be safe from this virus. Our hope is in God. Our hope as a nation, as America, is in God. It's not in us, in what we do, in what we create. So now is a time to make sure what we believe in, who we believe in. So it's time to double down on our faith. I want to encourage you to double down on your prayer time or even your Bible reading. You know, put your confidence in the right one, not the wrong thing. And God is always the right one. Also, in addition to help, you don't have to do this solo. That's why we're providing these experiences for you online. But I want to encourage you too, just to pick up the phone. Call your friends and say, hey, y'all, listen, I'm a little nervous right now. What do you hear God saying? Because I'm not hearing from God very well right now. What is God saying to you, you know, in this time? Because God may have a word for you through them, through their voice, or vice versa. You might be able to help them. Ask Jesus, Jesus, what are you trying to teach me? Even though you didn't cause this problem that we're suffering from, what do you want me to learn from it? So how I can grow through it and come out the other side stronger in faith because of you carrying me. What do you want me to know, Jesus? You know, fear will always lead you to make bad decisions. Peter thought he was making a good decision, but it was actually a bad decision because it wasn't Jesus' decision. But he did it out of fear. So fear will cause us to make the wrong decisions. But faith in God lets God make the decisions. Listen to Jesus. It's always the safest way. Next, I want you to understand that as we're all experiencing this weird disruption and our schedules are changing, and even some people not only are having to work from home, but some people may be hearing that, hey, listen, we're not going to be sending you a check for the next few weeks until we get out of this problem. You know, everything is being turned upside down. But you need to know that though this may scare us, God's not scared. And God's actually going to use this time of chaos for your benefit. I say that because it's true. Turn to Romans 8:28. You'll find there what the scripture says. Love this verse. When it was written 2,000 years ago, it was true. Guess what? It's still true today. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. Let me read that one more time. And we know that in all things, God works for the good, focus in on that word, for the good of those who love Him. Now, the word here that was written by Paul, the Greek word is agathos. And it's interesting how it's used in the scriptures. Over in Mark 10:18, Jesus was teaching about the fact that God the Father is holy and that God is perfect. And so he said, no one is good but God alone. All right, so he's referring there to the Father. So he says the Father alone is good. Now, that same word that you find there written by Paul, agathos, is the exact same word that Mark uses to describe what is good, the good that God will do in your life. Hang on to that. Over in the Old Testament, you kind of see the same trend. Very, very interesting. In Genesis 1:18, it says that God has made the sun. Back in the beginning, when He created the world, He made the sun, He made the moon, He made the stars. He made everything up in the sky. And it says there in the scripture, and God saw that it was good. Over a little bit later on in Genesis, after God made the animals, it says, and God saw that it was good. So I want you to think about that. When God made your pets, when He made dogs or cats or fuzzy little chipmunks or lambs or cows, God, or peacocks, God looked at that and said, you know, it is good. That's what He was declaring it to be. He saw that it was good. Now, I want you to notice something in Scripture is that interesting way that God communicates to us is that God never over-exaggerates things. Typically, He has a tendency to understate things. So, when God looks at something, when He makes the 200 billion stars or suns that are out there in the solar system and beyond in our universe, and when God makes the beauty of the stars and the sun and the moon and all of them set in place, God look at that and think it's good. Well, we would look at that and say, oh my gosh, God, it's not just good. This is phenomenal. This is incredible. I can't believe what I'm seeing. This is the most magnificent, the greatest thing of good I've ever seen in my life. This is incredible. So, taking that, listen to this verse again. God works for the good of those who love Him. What that means is that in your life as a Christian, because you love God and you worship Him, God is working for your maximum best in every situation. Even when things are falling apart, even when things that He didn't create are happening and viruses plague us, even in the midst of corona, guess what? God is somehow, some way, I don't know how He's going to do it, but He's going to make this work out for your maximum good. And that's what He promises. So it'll be kind of fun on the backside of this to look back and see, wow, God, I can see what You did through that to help me. Thank You, God. Last thought I want to share with you, and then we'll go to the next part of the worship service, is that we've been given this ordinance by the city that we are to shelter in place. In other words, we're not supposed to leave our homes unless, of course, we have to go to our business, we have to go to work, or we have to go to the grocery store. The idea is that we don't go out to the movies, we don't get an ice cream, we don't go out to Sanford Stadium for G-Day and spread the virus around 92,000 people. So we can't go out, we're supposed to stay in. Well, you can't go out, but you can reach out. And here's ways that you can do that. You can reach out with your telephone. You can reach out just like we did recently as a staff. We had a Zoom conference call. Actually, I think Glenn set it up on Google Meets. And we had a conference call with everybody on staff. And it was really good because we can encourage each other. And we prayed with each other as well. So use the power. Leverage the power of technology, you know, for your benefit. Get on Facebook. Get on Instagram. Whatever it takes. But just to get the word of God out and to reassure people. Minister to them in this time of crisis. Last Sunday, when church had to be canceled because we wanted to follow the president and the governor's orders about not meeting together with groups larger than 10, we had to close the facilities here. Well, I remember around 11 o'clock, I was in the back parking lot, and a couple cars pulled up. One of them belonged to a great family, the Mann family, and then another, the Edgar family. And I stood in between them, and I was talking to them because we couldn't go into church. But what we did was we actually had church there on the asphalt. And so I started reading to them some different psalms, including Psalm 91. And as I was reading it, Kenneth and Jennifer, they had their children. Two of their sons, Luke and Alan, in the back seat. And as I was going through this, reading the psalm, I was kind of, I was praying it, but I think a little preaching came out too that I was doing. I was just feeling the Spirit. And so as I was doing that, observing social distancing, complying with CDC guidelines, because we were a healthy distance from the cars, from each other, at that time, I didn't know it, but Alan Mann, who's a high school kid in our youth group, Alan was taping it on his cell phone, and within about an hour of him, after we had that little time of worship there in the parking lot, he went back home, he got on his cell phone, he took about a 2 or 3 minute video clip of that, of me reading out scripture and praying and kind of preaching, and he put it on his Instagram page, and it had a title something like Drive-Through Preaching. And so, but he sent it out to all of his friends, and he was getting a lot of views, and people were liking and so forth. And you know what? When I grow up, I want to be like Alan Mann. I want it to be my first instinct, which was Alan's. Even though he couldn't go out of the truck and go out to the sanctuary and worship with the church family. He couldn't go out, but he decided to reach out with what he had, with what God put in his hands. And so he made that, he sent it out, and so people were able to have the word of God and a prayer deposited by the Holy Spirit into their souls. And so I want to encourage you to be like Alan Mann. You may not be able to go out, but reach out. Reach out this week, all week long, because people need to hear your voices of encouragement and hope in this time. And as I close, let me remind you of this. The greater is Jesus in you than all the coronavirus that's in the world. God bless you all. Have a great week. All right. Glenn?
Just a reminder that we'll be sending out more information and updates by email. If you're not on our email list, just send an email to info@sjumc.org, and we'll make sure you get added to that and continue to check our website for more updates. Receive now the benediction from the Lord this morning. When Jesus was transfigured before Peter and James and John, they heard God's voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." The writer of the letter to the Hebrews begins his letter by stating, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son." And now we have the final revelation of God's plan in Jesus Christ in the Holy Scriptures, in the Bible. So let's listen to Christ, because he is our hope. And now may the God of hope himself fill you with all joy and peace, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope by believing.